So we mentioned that the... So we just mentioned how the ancient peoples actually had a lot of things right. That doesn't mean they had everything right. In fact, you probably are already familiar with, they did definitely had some things wrong. For example, anciently, people believed that the Earth was the center of the universe. That the sun, moon, all the planets, and everything actually orbit around the Earth. That the Earth was the center. Now, to be fair, I can kind of understand where they're coming from. For example, if you've ever watched a sunrise or sunset, think about what it looks like. It does not look like the Earth is rotating. It looks like the sun is moving. It's even in the words we use. It is a sunset or a sunrise. The thing that is moving is the sun. But, again, we realize that's not what's actually going on. So, they actually had a lot of evidence to suggest that the Earth was not, in fact, moving. Now, it's because they were naive. They didn't have a great understanding. They didn't have as much knowledge as what we have now. But I can forgive them. I do understand where they're coming from. But, again, they believed that the Earth was the center of everything. And this is because it appears that the sun and moon and stars all revolve around the Earth. Now, we've mentioned previously that both the sun and moon appear to move compared to the background of stars. The sun and moon actually move eastward from one day to the next. It's actually really easy to tell with the moon. So one of the observation projects is to actually track the phases of the moon for a couple of weeks. And if you actually do this, you can tell really easily how much the moon moves. The sun is also moving compared to the background of stars. Now, in this case, it's a lot harder to tell because you don't really see the stars when the sun's up. So you have to pay attention to what's going on at night when the sun is down. But the sun is also moving compared to the background of stars. And again, they tend to move eastward from one night to the next. Well, as the ancients were studying the sky, they noticed that there were other things that also moved. Now, these things looked like stars, but they moved compared to the other stars. So they referred to these as wanderers. In fact, the term that we now have planet comes from the ancient Greek word for wanderer. So we have these wandering stars that would move compared to the other stars. Now, generally, these would move in the same way as the sun and moon, generally traveling eastward from one night to the next. However, the planets would do something the sun and moon never did. So the planet would generally travel eastward, but then all of a sudden they would stop and travel backward for a time before stopping and then going forward again. This backward motion is what we refer to as retrograde. Anytime you see retrograde, and we're going to see it a few more times throughout the course, retrograde means backwards, moving the opposite way that we would normally expect. So generally, the planets would move eastward like the sun and the moon, but all of a sudden they would stop and travel backward. Well, this caused a problem. Based off of their understanding, the Earth had to be the center of everything. And we can easily explain the motion of the sun and the moon, but how is it that these planets could actually travel backwards? So one of the ideas to explain this is that the planet didn't just go around the Earth. They absolutely did go around the Earth, but they had another motion on top of it. So the idea is that the planet had an orbit on top of the orbit that went around the Earth. So here we have the Earth at the center. Then we have this big circle that goes around the Earth. This is what was referred to as the deferent. Now, on top of the deferent, the planet actually moved on a smaller circle. So the center of the small circle would move along the deferent, and then the planet would move around what is referred to as the epicycle. So when the planet is on the far side of its epicycle, it would move the way that we would expect. It would travel eastward from night to night. But when the planet swung inside of the epicycle, then it would travel backwards for a time. And this way we could explain the forward and then backward and then forward motion that we tend to see with planets. So the Earth is the center of everything, and we can explain retrograde motion. Now, for a time, this was totally good. But remember that one of the things that the ancient Greeks did was applied math. So they wanted to apply math to see if they could predict when and where the planet was going to begin retrograde motion. And when they did this, they found that it was terrible. They were off by several degrees in the sky and off by several weeks of time. So that's a problem. But they figured adding one epicycle gave us retrograde motion. So maybe if we put another epicycle on top of this epicycle, then we could get things to work. So when they did that and then they reapplied the math, things got better. Instead of being off by several degrees, they're off by a couple of degrees. And instead of being off by weeks, they're only off by a week. So it got better, but it's still not good enough. So the idea was then add another epicycle. And so putting epicycles on top of epicycles, trying to get to where the prediction and what's actually happening matched up. Now, this was the state of things from about the time of the ancient Greeks until the 1500s. Now, in the 1500s, there was a priest by the name of Nicholas Copernicus who felt that this geocentric model, known as the Ptolemaic model, named after Ptolemy, who was the one who kind of codified and finalized everything, he felt that this Ptolemaic model was very complicated. I mean, we've got circles on tops of circles on tops of circles. It's pretty messy and complicated. So Copernicus felt that a heliocentric or sun-centered model was simpler. Now remember the entire reason why we began the epicycles. Epicycles were invented to help explain retrograde motion. So the question is, can we still explain retrograde motion where if the Earth is moving around the Sun instead of the Sun moving around the Earth? Now, before we get into that, I'd like to draw on what I'm hoping is common experience. Hey, I'm hoping that you've had the experience of passing somebody on the freeway who's going slower than you are. Now, think about what happens as you're passing the slower person. As you're passing by, it appears that the person is traveling backward. Now, they're not actually traveling backward compared to the road. They're still going forward and probably actually going really fast because it's the freeway. However, in that time that you're passing them, it appears that they are traveling backwards. Well, as we consider planets orbiting around the sun, planets actually orbit around the sun at different speeds. Planets that are closer to the sun orbit faster than planets that are farther out. We'll talk more about this later when we talk about Kepler's laws of planetary motion. So in this diagram, we have the Earth on the inside circle, and we have Mars on the outside circle. So generally, the Earth and Mars are traveling along happily, but because the Earth is traveling faster, we are moving, we will actually pass by Mars. And in this time that we pass by Mars, it appears that Mars stops and travels backwards for a time. Okay, this is the cause of retrograde motion. Okay, and I hope that you can see that this is a far simpler explanation than what we talked about with retrograde motion as explained in the geocentric model. All right, here is our first clicker question. In the heliocentric model, retrograde motion happens when A, one planet passes another in its orbit, B, the planet is on the inside path of its epicycle, C, the planet stops momentarily, or D, there is no reasonable explanation for retrograde motion. Go ahead and think about it, and we'll discuss in just a bit. All right, so how do we explain retrograde motion in the heliocentric model? It is A, that one planet passes another, which is far simpler than having circles on circles on circles.